So I don't know if you can tell what this picture is. Anyone have an idea? Pardon? I heard James say something. But okay, there's cars lining up for sure. And the purpose they're lining up for, this is an aerial view of a coronavirus testing station in, I believe it's Milwaukee. And this just is a kind of a quick idea of the amount of demand that there is for information. And so we're going to attempt to provide you with a little information in the next couple of minutes that I am a, as a retired ER doctor, I am a coronavirus geek, and I just kind of watch the newspapers and online news sources to try and learn as much about what's going on as I can. And I read this quote from the former Baltimore Health Commissioner Leanna Wynn, who was interviewed yesterday, and she says, "Now we have one person being diagnosed of coronavirus every second in the United States. We have one American dying of coronavirus every 2 minutes in the United States, and that number is increasing." And this is also increasing worldwide. The United States is, if we haven't already passed 9 million, we're right at that point. Total cases yesterday, record-setting 91,744 new cases and 929 deaths. This is from Johns Hopkins University, who keeps kind of a running scoreboard on this. And during the week preceding, 536,000 new cases. So we are, if we're turning any corners, it's we're turning a corner towards an increase in the epidemic. And I'm sorry to say that, contrary to information that we're being given. This is the statistics from yesterday at the Tulsa County Health Department. What we have been doing is working, but you can see there in that middle graph, daily cases, that actually there is some beginning to be some increase again. And so that is not a good thing. Also, look at the hospital admissions in the upper right corner there as you're looking at the screen. The hospital admissions are increasing dramatically as well. And this is a newspaper article from a couple days ago quoting the administrator at St. Francis Hospital here in town, who says that their ICU is essentially full. And this is, it's full from cases coming from all over the area, not just from Tulsa. And part of the reason for that is Tulsa is the only area in this vicinity that has a mask mandate. The rest of them are just going around with their faces uncovered and getting sick. So this is something for us to, I think, raise awareness with people we know in other suburbs and areas around Tulsa, and our friends and family, that this is going to be even more of a problem, because if the beds all become full, what happens? Somebody doesn't get a bed that needs one. And the big problem is not the beds so much as it is the people to take care of individuals that are in the beds. So that's really a big concern. The healthcare workers are becoming burned out and worn out, and PTSD and whatever else you want to think about from this situation. And you can see on this graph from the Tulsa County Health Department that green line is trending slightly upwards, not as much as it has sometimes in the past, but it's still trending upwards. And this is, we talk about deaths, this is the 40-year-old chairman of the police officers union here in Tulsa just died from complications of coronavirus infection. So this can happen to anybody. It does not just happen to old people. Even if it doesn't happen to you, you might make someone sick that it will happen to. So we just have to each one be our brother's keeper in this time. Now, this brought me to the concerns about voting. I voted early, and a lot of people have done that. In fact, in the United States right now, there are more people who have voted than voted in the whole last election. That's before Election Day. So that shows that people are anxious to have their voice count, but there are definitely changes that happen when we vote. And I read a article, an editorial in the Review by Dwight Nelson about voting. If you want to look in your Review at home, or if you want to go online to Review and Herald and look in this last issue, there's an editorial by Dwight Nelson about voting, and he points out that there's a lot of emphasis on winning, isn't there, in an election. But he reminded us that Jesus' way of dealing with others is this verse in Mark 8:35. Whoever wants to save their life, I got an extra phrase in there, will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. So in God's way of looking at things, losers count more than winners, don't they? And if someone wants to win at any cost, and any doing anything in order to win, that's not the way that Jesus would do it. And he pointed out that in the past, Adventists have had problems with voting because it seems like none of the candidates are really good. But about the time of the Civil War, Ellen White and other leaders in the church begin to see that there is a time when we have to vote for what seems best for the nation and what goes along best with what God wants for us. And if there is gross lawlessness and lying, then we need to make our voices known, even though in the end we don't put our trust in political candidates, do we? We put our trust in God, and it just reminded me of the wonderful story, the book of Daniel. Every single chapter, practically, and all the different little stories that come out of the book of Daniel all point back to this idea that God is the one who is in control of kingdoms and nations. And we have to put our trust in God, don't we? So I think it's fine to vote, and I encourage you to do so. But remember that our trust is in the Lord, not in a politician. So as we've done every week, I want to close these few comments with this verse from Psalm 91. Surely he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. And we claim this promise as we face this week ahead and all the challenges that may come ahead of us. We put our trust in the Lord for whatever problems that may arise. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful for the privilege of being your children, and of when things get bad, we can shelter in the safety of your wings. We can take refuge in you as our strength and our protector. And we just pray today that we will keep these thoughts foremost in our minds and in our daily experience in the days ahead, which may be troublesome days. There may be things come upon our nation that will be of grave concern for all of us. But let us remember to keep our trust in you. In everything that we face, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. As we do every week, we want to thank you, Dr. Carrico, for keeping us abreast and apprised of the various situations that we're faced with the coronavirus. And at this time, I want to say welcome to all of you who have come to worship with us today at the First Tulsa Seventh-day Adventist Church. We know that right across the hall, the parking lot over there, the school is having their TEA Alumni Weekend. But we're glad for you who are sitting in with us here today. We've come to worship God in the beauty of holiness. Amen. God has been so good to us. You know, as we think about this past week, for the most part, we had a lot of rain this week, and it was kind of glum and dreary, right? Even though we needed the rain, it got a little much for us. But anyway, God knows what is best for us and what we need, and we're thankful to be his children. On this Sabbath morning, the sun is shining and God is smiling down upon us in a very special way, because you have chosen to honor him by your allegiance to him, by coming to worship him. You know, the Bible says the Sabbath is a sign between God and man, that we are his and he is ours. And so that's why we come today. And the other good news I have to mention to you is that I always like to say, we're one Sabbath closer to the coming of the Lord. Amen? Now that ought to make everybody happy. We're so glad that Jesus is coming. We want to share that good news with those with whom we meet throughout the day and throughout the week. As we go throughout as we think about the announcements, just want you to be mindful of, first of all, we always like to remind folk, as we come to church, we want to remind you that when we leave, we want to make sure we keep the hallways clear and we can take our conversation outside, because we want to always maintain social distancing, you know, so that we can keep each other safe and be just as cognitive as we can and responsible. We're also, this week, we're blessed to have Dr. Karol Mosley with us speaking this Sabbath. We're continuing our series on America's Got Flavor, and so we're honored that she's here with her husband today to share the Word of God. And I want you to begin praying for her right now, as God has given her a message to share with us, but we still need to continue to pray that the Spirit of God will move upon her to give us the Word, but also that we will have the receptive ears to appreciate what God has to share with us. Amen? Remembering tomorrow, time, tomorrow, we're going to flick our clocks back tomorrow, so we just be mindful of that. It's a good time of the year. We get a little extra time to sleep, I guess. I don't know. But anyway, you can get up earlier and maybe spend a little bit more time reading in the Word of God. Tulsa Community Service Center, also Wednesday from 2 to 4, we want to remind you that they're still in the business of seeking to give out food to those who are needy. Also, to an extra point, they're looking for donations. They're trying to get the AC, the refrigeration, and, you know, there's always issues. So if you have pray about it and see if God will move upon you to help them financially as they're seeking to improve their base of operation in the Tulsa area. It's a very good ministry. Prayer meeting. We want to remind you about prayer meeting. We're meeting here in the church on Wednesday evening. This particular Wednesday, we're on chapter 3 of Ephesians. The pastor says it's going to be an explosion. So we want to encourage you to come if you can. If you cannot, we want to remind you that it is online. You can get it by Zoom, and the instructions are there for you to, if you get on our website, you can get them. If you have an issue, give me a call or call Dr. Carrico. Now, Dr. Carrico's got enough to call me, because he's working so much, I don't want to give him any more work. Call me and we'll try to get you on the Zoom, all right? And so that you can be a participant in that way. Not Zoom? It's online. Well, I was going to say I knew that, but I didn't know that. But it is live stream, and so you can get us on live stream and you can participate in that way. Also, the pastor always wants to remind folk, listen, he wants to meet with you in person or on the porch, by the phone, by text, or by phone. He wants to get in touch with you so that he can make that connection. So look in the bulletin and decide how you want to visit with him or connect with him. He wants to meet with you and pray with him. with whatever challenge or blessing you'd like to share. He wants to be a participant in that. Reminding you also, too, that this is a very fruitful place. We have a baby shower coming up, and that is on November the 8th. It's for the Vargas, Ruthie and Jason Vargas. They were here this morning. They're across the way there. And so we want to remind you to of that time and be a participant in that as well. What am I missing? I think that's just about it. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Tonight they're having a hayride. It's TAA. They're having the weekend, but tonight is a fundraiser for the school. It's always good for the students and for the teachers. They're always needing extra, and so it's at the McGahee, I almost said plantation, at the McGahee farm. That guy back there is going to be at his house. Raise your hand, Marvin. All right. It's going to be at his house, and if anybody needs directions, you can get with me or get with that gentleman there, and we can make sure you get there. We want to support our school as best we can. So glad that you came to the house of the living God today. We're so glad that God has kept you through the week. There have been many challenges, as we've mentioned, but God has kept us through them all. Amen? And God has promised that he is going to be faithful. You know, I was reading Revelation 21, and we mentioned it again and again this morning. The good news, there's so much good news in Revelation 21, but one in particular that I like, it says, Revelation 21, I think 3 or 4, it says, God himself will be there with his people. Amen? We long to be in the presence of God, don't we? We long to see Jesus who went on the mission of mercy and love to redeem us. And we have come today because we love him. Amen? We love him. And that's why we choose and we recite from Sabbath to Sabbath, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all of thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day, and he hallowed it. I'm so thankful for Jesus. This time, would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we come. We're so thankful to be called children of God. We pray that you will come into our midst today as never before. And Lord, we pray that we will live changed lives because we have met with Jesus in this place on this day. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Stand and sing with us the songs of praise.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saints of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the rolling call of yonder army there, when the rolling call of yonder, dead in Christ arise, and the glory of his resurrection share. When his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the rolling call of yonder I'll be there. When the rolling call of yonder, when the rolling call of yonder, when the rolling call of master from the dawn to setting sun, let the song of all his wonders growing air. Then when all of life is over and our work is ended on, and the roll is called of yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called of yonder, when the road is far up yonder, I'll be there. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting.
To the Father, and we're going to sing, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High.
Lord, I lift Your name on high.
it's time for the children's story now. And even though the kids aren't collecting the offering, they still want you to remember the Worthy Student Fund, and you can mark it on the envelope. Thank you.
Good morning, boys and girls. Do you have any special jobs at home that your parents give you to do? Well, God had special work. He has special work for each one of us. And there was a certain woman in the Bible named Deborah, and God gave her a very important work to lead Israel. Do you think that would be a hard job? Well, it was. It was very hard work. The people didn't obey God. They worshiped idols instead. And 20 years earlier, King Jabin had attacked Israel, and he won the battle, made the Israelites his slaves. Now everyone lived in fear. They were afraid of the king and his general, Sisera. He had 900 chariots of iron. So Deborah was called a judge. She didn't have an office in a courthouse like judges do today. She sat outside under a palm tree. When people had a problem, they came to her to help them find a solution to their problems. They asked her for advice. Again and again, she heard how the people were sorry for turning away from God and for worshiping idols. They asked her to teach them to worship the true God. And one day, God spoke to Deborah. He said, "I have heard the prayers of my people, and I will deliver them from slavery." Deborah listened to God's instructions. She gave the instructions to Barak, the army commander. "God wants you to take 10,000 men to Mount Tabor. He will lead Sisera into your hands." Barak was afraid. He knew how mean and cruel Sisera's army was. They had attacked his town. But Barak respected Deborah, and he knew that God had spoken through her. "If you will go with me and my army, I will go," Barak replied. Well, when Deborah agreed to go with him, God gave her a second message for Barak. "Because you want me to go with you, you will not have the honor of winning the battle. That victory will go to a woman." Deborah, Barak, and the 10,000 soldiers did very little fighting. As Barak and his men went out to meet Sisera, God stepped in. Sisera and his army left their chariots and ran away. Barak and his men caught them and destroyed the army. But all in the confusion, Sisera escaped. Sisera traveled on until he came to Jael's tent. Jael's husband was one of his friends, so Sisera thought he would be safe there for a while. Sisera asked Jael for something to eat and a place to hide while he rested. But Jael knew that Sisera was a wicked man. While he slept, she killed him. And that is how Deborah's prophecy came true. A woman named Jael killed Sisera. Barak didn't, because Barak was afraid. God uses a variety of people, many different people, as leaders in his church. Men and women, old and young, rich and poor. Children can also be God's leaders too. God will help all who love and follow him to be good leaders. We need to listen to God's chosen leaders so we can learn from them and understand God's plan for our lives. When God asks us to do something, we want to be ready to obey him. And there's a verse that says, "Show proper respect to everyone. Love the family of believers, fear God, honor the emperor," just like we respect our president and the people in our church family. And it's 1 Peter 2:17. So remember, boys and girls, each one of us is important to God, and he loves each one of us. You have a wonderful Sabbath.
Thank you, Lisa, for the for the children's report, story. At this time, we would like to just remind you it's our time that we generally take up the tithes and offering. First of all, I should say, got all this stuff here. First of all, I should say thank you very much for your beneficence. And we are so thankful that you have been faithful over the last few months, especially during this coronavirus. We want to encourage you to continue to do so. God is a God who's able to supply all of our needs, and we're so thankful that you have responded in time. We want to remind you that there are several ways to give. Of course, we have the boxes in the back on the walls. We don't take up with the plates anymore. Also, you can go online, which is the easiest way of using the app. That's the best way. The treasurer likes to use it that way. That way, there's no, you know, it's just a matter of punching in a few buttons. And so it makes it easier that way if you're able to do that. But in the meantime, you can, like I said, you can put them in the boxes that are hanging on the back there. This week's offering, it was on the screen there, is for Southwestern Adventist University. We want to remind you that if you do not mark your tithe envelope, all of the loose money that will be taken up will be given to Southwestern Adventist University, that is in Keene, Texas, and so just be mindful of that. We want you to give intelligently and responsibly, so we want to inform you of that. So glad that God has been so generous and gracious to you, you are responding in time as well. As we continue our worship, so before I sit down, we should be mindful that we also take time for prayer at this time, and I'm just mindful of the Bible text that it says in Isaiah. It talks about, it says, "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?" It says, "He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not." Then verse 5, it says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed." The Bible reminds us, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before his shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. And so as we come to this part in our worship service, our hearts are softened, you know, as we think about the great love that God has for us. We need to think about Jesus. Folk, we think too much of the other things that are out there. We need to focus our attention on the love of Christ. He was bruised for my iniquity, for my transgression. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. With his stripes, we are healed. We need to spend time thinking about that, what Jesus is doing for us. And today, if you're online or ride along in your car on Facebook, 2 or 3 days later, call upon the name of Jesus, amen. Call upon Jesus. Ask Jesus to reveal himself to you. Ask Jesus to empower you to live a godly life. Ask him to set you free from whatever's got you. You know, some of us is just angry, and we need to ask God to take that from us as well. He's willing to come and make us brand new. And so this time we'd ask that you would bow with me as far as possible as we go before the throne of grace. And God, we do pour out our hearts to you at this time, Lord. We come into your presence, Lord. We ask you in a very special way for your presence, Lord. Come near to us, Lord. You know all about us. You know the struggles that we have. You know the victories we've gained. You know all about us. And so we come today. Nobody else knows, just you and me. We come and we ask, Lord, for deliverance from everything that separates us from you. And Lord Jesus, as we contemplate the week that is before us, Lord, we think of the election that is coming up, Lord, these United States. We pray for the peace of God to be in the possessions of your people with what no matter what comes. We need to have peace as never before. Peace and the assurance that Jesus is able to do it far more exceedingly abundantly all that we ask or think. We need to have the peace to know that we're kept by his grace, that we're kept for now and for eternity. Oh, Father in heaven, bless this church as you've never blessed it before. We think of the speaker of the hour, Lord. We pray your child, Lord, Dr. Karol Mosley, Lord. Oh, God, speak through her today. May heaven come down, and may we have the gladsome testimony that it was good for us to have been in the house of the living God because Jesus was there. And I am a witness to it. And then as we are filled with the Spirit of God, we pray that we will impart the words of truth, the words of life to those with whom we meet all along the way. Thank you, because you promised. And you have never failed us, and you won't fail us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Singing the song of the month with us, Living Hope.
Yeah.
Happy Sabbath, church family. Those who are here in the building and those who are watching online, I'm super excited for this Sabbath. And one of the reasons I'm super excited for this Sabbath is because though I may not be here, we have with us a blessing sent from God. We have with us Pastor Karol. And Pastor Karol is going to be continuing our series on America's Got Favor. And I don't know about you guys, but how many of you guys have been appreciating the series thus far? The series has been a blessing for myself, and I know that it has been a blessing for many. If you're confused, I encourage you to check out the last few videos of Pastor Nathan and myself, and get caught up on the series, because this series is a powerful one. And I know this Sabbath, not a lot of people are going to be here, but what I also know is God has given all of us the ability to be able to share. So I encourage you guys to share this specific Sabbath. Either find the video on Vimeo or on Facebook or on YouTube and share with somebody that maybe isn't here, or maybe somebody that you know that's going to need this message. And you'll be surprised in the impact that this can have when we share in faith. Also, something I want to make mention is continue to reach out. Continue to fill out the visitation forms so that we can still connect throughout the week. Because even though I'm not here, I still want to be able to have the opportunity to connect with you guys. So feel free to go on the website and look up the visit, or even look up my number on the back of the bulletin and give me a call, and let's connect throughout the week. And if you can't do that, then no worries. Feel free to join us for prayer meeting. That's going to be Wednesday. We're going through the book of Ephesians, and we're starting chapter 3 this next Wednesday. So I encourage you to connect with us so that we'll still be able to connect even though we may not be physically seeing each other. And we also have our prayer meetings being streamed live on YouTube or on Facebook. So feel free to look up maybe the past ones, or even join us for this next one. I'm super excited, and I know that this Sabbath you'll be blessed until God brings us back together again. Thank you, and God bless.
Amen. Amen.
That is on the minds, thank you, of Americans, of our country. And that is the natural disasters, the catastrophes, or if you will, the crisis that we are seeing right now. And I'm not sure if you're aware that, I'm sure if you're watching the news, you've probably seen it, that on the West Coast, the number of fires that we have seen in just 2020 is unprecedented. In California alone, since the time that they actually started recording fires, wildfires, the largest wildfire in that state occurred this year. Over 2 million acres have burned, were destroyed. And since that time that they were recording, out of the top 20 fires that have ever taken place in the state of California, 5 were this year. And just to our southeast, in the state of Louisiana, just once again this week, another hurricane, 5 hurricanes, major hurricanes, have landed in that particular state. I'm not sure if you're aware how they actually name hurricanes, but meteorologists go through the alphabet, A, B, C, X, Y, Z. And this year, in 2020, they ran out of the alphabetical letters, the English alphabet, rather, and they had to go to the Greek alphabet. So that's why we're getting storms Beta and Delta and Zeta. Those are Greek letters, unprecedented. We have not seen this before. And, of course, we're all affected, as Dr. Karol told us so well there. of the coronavirus, this pandemic, this unbelievable situation that we find ourselves in, and climate change. I don't know if you're aware that the climate, there is something going on. I won't get into the politics of it, but it is a political issue. And we as Christians should be concerned, because you know they are, pundits are saying climate change, that topic, that issue may very well decide a good percentage of the voters. They're looking who's going to handle the issues that are going on with our climate, because there's not another planet. There's no planet B. And some may not be Christians, but they're like, I want my child to be able to go outside and have clean air, have an area that they can play that's not polluted. They're concerned. So we as the people of God that know Jesus Christ should be concerned as well. How can we, how can we share what Jesus is saying, what God is saying in these last days with other people? And if you don't know Jesus, if you're looking in this crisis, we've got good news for you today. There is hope, and God has something to say about how we as his people and his children, every person, how we can make it through this crisis that we find ourselves in. So let us pray. Father, I thank you and praise you for this privilege to stand before your people, Lord. I do not take it lightly. I ask for your spirit, that we would understand by the end of this sermon where you are in the crisis and this crisis, and what should be our response. Have your will and way is my prayer request. In Jesus' name, amen. So today we're going to look, I don't know how you are affected, but we have all been affected in some form or fashion by this crisis. It may be in your family, it may be in finance, it may be physically. We had in our church at Adventist Fellowship, and greetings from Adventist Fellowship, we love you. We have a young lady there. Her 21-year-old sister actually died this year of COVID in New York City. So everyone has been affected in some form or fashion. And God is saying, I have something to tell you. I have a word. I have a way that I'm going to teach you and share with you how to make it through the crisis. Because normally when bad news does happen or something transpires, at the beginning, it's not that difficult. I mean, we can make it through somewhat. But what about in the middle as the days and the weeks and the months and the years go by? How do we make it to the end? And he told us in Matthew 10, he says, those that endure to the end shall be saved. So let us jump in. The Bible does have something to say on the book of Job, Job chapter 42. Before I go there, I want us to just look a little bit into Job's life. Just, and you may know the story, you may not. But Job, a man who God says was a righteous man. A man, he said that, he actually said he was perfect. And that word perfect doesn't mean he was sinless. He means he was mature. He, for what God had showed to him and revealed to him, Job walked in it. And so this particular day, sort of like us, just one day, everything changed. One day, we had gone to bed the night before. Everything, we had made plans. We're going to work. We're going to school. We're going to do this in the summer. All of these plans. And so one day, Job was just in life, waking up, and here, one after the other, the servant comes and tells him, Job, while I was out tending to the animals, there was an attack. And the only one that's left, all the servants, all the animals, gone. And before he could finish speaking, another one came. Job, there was another issue, there was a storm, Job. Your children, all the children. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. And do you know Job prayed for his children? He prayed. He would offer sacrifice. He would pray. He said, just in case, they may do something. So he prayed. He gave us an example, praying for our children, praying for the young people around us. And so he prayed for them. And the servant said, there was a wind, there was a storm, and they're gone. And he said, you know, you had some more cattle, you had sheep, all of this. He said there was a storm, all gone. Even your servants, all gone. I'm the only one left. So one thing, I mean, how do you take that? One crisis, your fortune, here's your family, your 10 children, This man would have to bury 10 children that he had birthed, his wife had birthed, you know, gone through 9 months, 9 months, 9 months, and 10. And then here, his fortune, his family. And then he said, naked I came into the world, naked I will depart, blessed be the name of the Lord. What a blessing, because that says a lot about Job. And then Job, we know why. This was not really anything to do with Job, but then he was covered from head to toe with sores, boils. And the word says he would take like a piece of clay and just scrape. That's how itching and uncomfortable and hurting and painful. And so Job, that was just the first two chapters of the book. There's 42. And so the next 35 chapters, here come his friends. His friends are talking to Job. You would think in that kind of a situation, the friendship that we've developed, the friends that we have, would be there comforting and saying, yes, Job, you can make it. Job, I'm here for you. Job, how can I comfort you, Job? And his friends started accusing him. You've done something, Job. There's no way that you have said you've walked with God all this time. We've seen you in your glory days. We've seen you sitting at the gate and people would listen to you. Job would walk by, it says in the word, it says, and that people would look at him and watch him. He was respected, he was honored. How could this happen to you, Job? You must have done, you have skeletons in your closet. That's what he said to him. And Job said, No. I, he didn't say it was perfect. He says, but I didn't cause this. They had a belief system at that time. When you had calamity, when you had catastrophe or some crisis, you must have contributed to it. So if a child was born that maybe was a special needs child, the parents did something. So this was a wrong representation, but this is what they came to Job with. So for all of those chapters, 35 chapters there, they were just going back and forth. Job, it's you. Job, repent. Job. And Job said, no, I haven't done anything. I don't know what you're talking about. But then he, at the beginning, he was very strong. He said, God, if you slay me, yet will I praise you. Yet will I trust you. But then as time went on, he said, God, where are you? I don't know where you are, God. It's almost like, God, I've become your enemy. God, I served you. I've done everything. What have I done? Where are you, God? Why can't you stop this? So we want to jump in today, right after God, for 35 chapters, he did not say a word. And then God said to him, he said, before I get to my main text there, he says to Job, as he's saying to Tulsa, as he's saying to each of us, he says to him, he says, where were you? Where were you when I created the earth? Where were you when I told the Pacific Ocean, stop there and go no more? Where were you when, you know, that thing that you're sitting on, planet Earth, and I fastened it there? I you don't even understand. It's not nails, and you didn't go to Lowe's. He didn't have to go to Home Depot. He says, I made it. It stays together. Where were you, Job? Where were you, Tulsa, first? Where were you? Were you there? He's asking us, were we there? He says, do you even understand how I measured and why I measured the earth and made the earth the circumference that it is? Do you know that? Were you there? He says, when the morning stars sang together, were you there? When I created the sun, moon, and stars, was any human being there? And so he was telling Job, he says, after all this, you've had family, you've had your fortune, you've had your physicality, and even your friends, who now? You have finally come to the point that you realize that I am God. He is God. He says, I am the creator. This is my universe. This is where I live. I'm not going anywhere. This is mine. So he was telling Job, he says, Job, I want you to understand something about me. And so he was expressing to Job who He is. And he's telling us today, even in the crisis, even in the difficulty, even in the pandemic, the climate change, the hurricanes, the earthquakes, the fires, he says, I am God. This is my planet. This is my universe. And I'm not going anywhere. I will be with my people wherever you are. So let's see what Job does. So this is what God, he spoke to Job. And so God just shared with him and revealed him. Really, that's what it was. He revealed himself. It says it was in a whirlwind, what we would call just an expression. He revealed who he was a bit to Job. And so let's look in. Let's go to our scripture now. So this is Job's response. This is Job. This is what. So 42 verse 1. Let's go back to verse 1. I haven't said that. So Job answered the Lord. God says, I have something I want to talk with you with. Okay. And he says, and this is what Job said. He answered God. He said, God, I know now that you can do not some things, but many things, everything. I know. Now he's still head to toe in pain. Head to toe in boils. His children gone. The fortune gone. But he says, now I know. I know. And he's going to tell us how he came to this conclusion. I know that you, God, not me, not some group of people, not praise God for family, praise God, but they're not above God. Praise God for fortune. If you have fortune, whatever your financial situation, praise God for it, but it's not above God. And he's saying, I know our physicality, praise God for our physical health, but it's not above God. Our friends, praise God. I hope you have good friends and friends are with you, but the friends are not above our God. And so he says, I know you can do everything. And that no purpose of yours, whether I understand it or not, no purpose of God's. He says, nothing of yours. When you purpose God, it will come to pass. It cannot be withheld. It will come to pass. Whatever you want. He was saying emphatically, intentionally, God, I've realized something in this crisis that you are in control. You are God. And everything is in your hands. Whatever happens to us, whatever the crisis is, it is you are and can do everything. You're capable, God. You're powerful enough to do everything, not just some things. Next slide. And so he goes on. He said, you asked, who is this who hides counsel without knowledge? So God had asked him, he said, when he revealed himself, he says, Job, are you giving counsel on something you do not understand? Because we do not understand everything. Maybe we do not understand that. As human beings, we are finite. He's the creator. We're the creation. So there are going to be things we do not understand. And many times, we're just saying what we think. And he got to a point. What happened in Job? Job actually started complaining. He actually started saying, oh, why was I even born? The day of my birth. Why didn't I? Why? But did he not know that was a direct attack, really, on God? Because it's God who created us. It's God who helped us to come through our mother's womb to be here. So he started this complaining, this mentality. And he's going to help us to come out of that and to be delivered from that today. So he said, God, you asked me, God, who is hiding this counsel? Who has this counsel? It doesn't read very well. In the original, it says, who has this counsel? Did you? Are you trying to teach other people and you really don't know? Is what he's saying. He said, therefore, I have uttered. This is Job now. He said, therefore, I have uttered. He said, God, I have spoken things that I did not understand. Things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Now here he is in the midst of the crisis. And he says, I'm sorry, God. I've actually spoken about you. I've misrepresented you in the crisis. So I propose to you, family, that God is telling us he wants us to rightly represent him in the crisis, in this crisis and any crisis that we encounter in this world. And so we're going to learn how to do that. He says, I'm sorry, Lord. Next slide. things I have uttered. He says, yes, things too wonderful. Next slide, please. He said, listen, listen. Now, before, by the end of those 35 chapters, Job had gotten a little bold and actually a little, he was rather disrespectful. He demanded, God, answer me. Don't do that to God. I pray not. Answer me, Lord, take me out of this situation. I can handle no more. I cannot take it, God. Move, God, I need this now. Do it, I pray not. But Job is teaching us a lesson today. He asked, he shifted, because now he had a revelation of God. Now he had had an encounter with God, an experience with God. He had begun to really listen to God, not to just others, not to just friends, not to just family, but he's listening to the voice. He heard what God said and what God revealed to him. And he said, Lord, can I speak now? Lord, yeah. When we have a relationship and an authentic experience with the God of this universe, God the Father, God the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, we will be humble. Because this is, we have not made anything. This is his world. We are his creation. The breath that we just took is his. The reason, the capability and the abilities that we have is from God. Every good thing, even the difficult things, it's because he loves us. And so to be rude or brash, now he's not saying you can't question or ask questions, but we're before the God of this universe who has made everything, who is omnipotent, omniscient. He knows everything. He knows everything about us and he still loves us. Who sent his only son to die in our place for what we have done. When we were offensive to him, when we missed the mark, when we were gossiping and rude and lustful and hateful, he said, I'm sending my son because I love you. That God, let us be wise in how we approach this, our creator, our father. He says, I've realized something. So he says, listen, Lord, can I speak now, Lord? Not answer me. Maybe, no. He said, you said to me, God, you said, I will question you and I want you to answer me. So this is his answer to God. Yes. He says, I have heard of you by the hearing. But now my eye sees you. He says, I've heard, and many of us have heard, and that's a great thing, nothing wrong with it. I've heard from family. I've heard from friends. I've heard many things about you, God, and that's wonderful. He says, and I've heard you just now. I've heard you. He said, but now, meaning praise God for all those years that he served. Praise God for the faithfulness. He says, but right now, God is a very present help. He wants us present with him daily. And I love the Sabbath school and how they brought that out each and every day. He's calling for us a real relationship. If you are in a relationship with someone, you don't go weeks without talking, or you just ignore them and you just do whatever you want and you just, I don't have anything to say to you. No, a relationship with God, with the God of this universe. He's inviting us to have a relationship. And Job says, now I had heard it. I heard. He says, but now I, not someone else, praise God for family, but you have to see for yourself. Praise God for friends. But until we have the vision and we can see the hand of God, we see God for ourselves. We see him in relationship. And they brought that out. I hope you're coming to your Sabbath school. It was really powerful. How do we see the face of God? Are we looking to Jesus Christ? So he says, but now my eyes, not someone else's eyes, not just what I've heard, but now, right now, presently, my eyes, I have spiritual vision now. I see you, God. He didn't say, most of us would say, Lord, praise God, I appreciate you talking to me, and thank God, but can you take these sores away? Can you just get rid of, and then we can go forward, we can talk more. Lord, can you just explain to me how we're going to deal with the loss of my children and how people are mocking. Because when we see God, when we really see Him, when we see Him in this crisis, we're not just going to be thinking of ourselves and our situation. We're going to be looking to Him. I see you, God. I'm not just concerned that, yes, you may have been gone through some situations financially. You may have been laid off. You may have, as this young lady at our church, her younger sister passed away. You may have gone through something because of the storms as well and all that's going on. But God says, I want each of you, individually and collectively, to see me. So that is the first thing. He says, seek ye first. You know that scripture in Matthew? He says, seek ye first. Matthew 6:33, it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And whatever we need in whatever storm, whatever crisis, He said, I will add it unto you. But the first thing that we need in these days is to seek God, to keep our focus on Jesus Christ. In 2020, vision. That's how we have 2020 vision, is by seeking the face of God. Be it a decision, be it a situation, be it, I have no idea what to do, and we don't know the crisis that is going to continue coming, but we know a God that is above every crisis and that can handle everything in the name of Jesus. So he says it's personal. Praise God for all this fortune, but the fortune's not going to help in a crisis. Praise God for family and bless them. And you know, we really can't be the husband, the wife, the child that God wants us to be anyway without Jesus Christ. So he says, you can't put family above me. I'm above family. I gave you that family. He says, the friends. Praise God for your friends. He says, but you cannot put that above me. Yeah, that's not your dependence. That's not your strength. That's not the one who's going to see you through. It is me, your God, your Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. So he says, it's personal. You've got to see me in the crisis. And he never went anywhere. Go ahead, the next slide. And this is just Job talking. He says, therefore, I abhor myself. In the original language, that means is I reject myself. He says, it's like, he says, what it really means is, he says, God is the macro, we're the micro. He says, I want to disappear. That's what he says. God, I've been thinking so highly. I've been thinking me. And I haven't even understood. What do you want, God? This is your world. I'm your child. This is about you. It's not about humanity. It's about you and what you want to do in humanity. But not just what I'm feeling or what I'm going through. And oh, this is so difficult. God, he says, I reject me. And what I've been thinking and how I've been looking at these situations and this crisis, he says, I abhor myself and I repent. His friends have been saying to him, repent. You know that secret you have. You know that skeleton. Repent, repent. But now it wasn't that Job had skeletons and secrets. He's repenting because he has realized that his perspective, his focus was on himself, on his losses, on his difficulty, instead of being on God. And he realized that instead of giving God the glory, instead of just trusting, because he had walked with God. You see, he was a faithful man, and that faith did help him through the journey. But it's not just the beginning of a journey or a crisis or the middle of a crisis. It's all the way to the end. And so Job tells us, he says, yes, you can start off strong, and that's great. Nothing wrong with it. But when people start saying things, when people start trying to put doubt, trying to attack and accuse and saying, well, you must be the problem. You see, and it's a very interesting story because Satan really was the one, he was the one saying to Job, about Job, oh, Job, he'll give it up. He'll give up the faith. And then his friends come along and says, Job, you're just all messed up. It's you that's caused this. But God is the one, next slide, the God is the one that is going to vindicate. He's going to tell them, his friends. And so it was after the Lord had spoken these words to Job. So they had a discourse that the Lord said to his friends, my wrath, God was angry at the friends. He says, what? He says, against you and your friends. He said, they've aroused my anger. He said, because they've spoken against you and they've spoken against me. They did not speak what is right. My question to you today Tulsa first. Tulsa, are we speaking what is right about God? Are we speaking and living what is right about our God? Can our neighbors see? Even though there are things going on, are we living in fear? Are we living in faith? Can our neighbors see us, even in the midst, keeping our eyes on Jesus, having a word for them, being kind, being loving, expressing who our God is? He says, they didn't speak. They thought they were doing the right thing. Oh, Job, we're going to tell you. And day after day after day, God said, no, you have not. You didn't speak of me rightly. You didn't speak of Job even. You misunderstood your own friend. Let me tell you something. People will misunderstand us. They will mistake us for somebody else. They don't even know. But what God says about us is true and authentic. And God tells us, he says in the last days, he's coming back. So he wants to say to each of us, well done, my good and faithful servant. But in order to have him express that to us, it can't just be about ourselves and we're just focused, we're hiding. You know, there are people now, they're building places and, you know, and I hope, I'm just telling you what God told me to say. They're building places, planning to hide out and wait till it passes and going to the various places. And nothing wrong with getting outside of the city, but we still have a work to do. He's never told us to hide and not say something. He's never told us to keep our mouths shut. He has told us to be his ambassadors of reconciliation. And so yes, we are having an election, you know. We're not elected, we're chosen. So praise God for whomever comes into office. You know, people are saying, oh, what will the world, what will the country be like? God is still God. Regardless, November 3rd, November 5th, he's still on the throne. He's still with us. He's going to see us through. Not just at the beginning, the middle, and the end until Jesus Christ returns. So it's up to us to have the right response. So first is seeking God, seeking the face of God, seeking him while he is found. Next slide. He said, I won't read through it. You can go back. He tells his friends, he says, go and offer to Job. Go and offer this up. He says, and then Job will pray for you. But what a difference. Here they had been accusing, you're the one wrong, and now God rebukes him and says, no, no, no. He says, Job, go to him. He says, then I will accept. I will accept the prayer of the one who stood the course, the one who was attacked and misunderstood, the one he didn't get everything right. But you see, when he humbled himself, when he got the right perspective, and God is saying, first seek him and listen to him so that we have the perspective that will be honorable to God and be a blessing to our family and our friends and our community. And sometimes we can think we're right and we're not. And so, but are we teachable? Because this is a school, as we're looking at in Sabbath school, this is education. This is the school of God. We're all in school. Okay, we're all in school, regardless if you have a worldly degree. We're in the school of God, the school of Christ. And he's saying to us, are you willing to learn? Are we willing to be taught by God? So we don't all get it right all of the time. And so understand this. If the book of Job, you know, the beginning of the book of Job said, if the book of Job were about, it says in the book of Job, he was a faithful man and all of that. But what if it didn't say the book of Job? What if it said the book of you? The book of me, the book of Carol. We're about, there was a woman named Carol in the land of Oklahoma. Because he's saying there's a book about each of us. Who was what? What would the book say? Not what we say, but what God would say. And so he says, who was this and that? And who treated God? How did we do that? And what do we do towards evil? Do we run towards it? Do we run from it? He's saying first, in order to make it through the beginning, the middle, and the end of a crisis, first get our minds on Jesus Christ. First, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then focus. Focus on what God is saying for your church, for you individually to be doing. It will be different. It will be different. We all have a different, we're the body of Christ, we have a different part to play here. He says, focus on that, and then he says to us, he says he's going to fulfill. He's going to fulfill, he says, his purpose in each and every one of us. Yes, that's what he says. And he's telling us in these last days, we are, you may be visiting here, I don't know. We are Americans. Or maybe you're visiting here, you're just a person here living. He says, but we're more than just Americans. We are his ambassadors. He has called us to be ambassadors. Praise God for our country. We love America, yet at the same time, that's not our home. Our home is in heaven. We are pilgrims coming through here. And he said, I have a purpose for each and every one of you, just like I did Job. And just fast forwarding, at the end of this discourse, God, after the end, Job did not ask, God, please give me. God says, now I'm going to restore. I'm restoring double. You had 7,000 camels, 14,000. You're going to have 10 more children. And three of these children, I just want to say, and then I'll be out of your way here. The first girl, her name was Jemima, and it meant dove. The second girl was Cassia or Cassia, something we use. It was like an oil that they used. It was the anointing oil. The third girl there, there was Corrine Hapuk. Hers was what we call antimony. Antimony is, I was a chemistry teacher before I became a pastor. And it's a metal. It's a something that we find in the earth, and they use it for medicine. They use it for beautification as well. And what happened was, you see, Job had a different mindset. After he went through this crisis, when he embraced God, when he accepted, he says, God, now I understand. It's about you. I'm subject to you. I'm submitted to you. I will obey you. I love you, and I receive your love. My life will be an example of who you are. I will reflect who you are, Lord, as I grow, as I mature with you. So what he did something that men would not do. He gave his daughters, he treated his daughters just like he would have treated the sons. He became a person of fairness. He became a person of equity. He became a person of love, not just saying it, but living it. And his children, his daughters, received inheritance just like the sons. That may not be a big deal, but in that country, that culture, it was. And he named his daughters, you're like a dove, you're anointing oil, you're beautiful, you're healing, and that's Jesus Christ. He's saying to us to make it through a crisis. We can't just say, I know Jesus. We have to live it. We have to love him. He has to be an integral part, every part of our lives. There's no no-go zones with Jesus Christ. It's everything. And that's what he's calling us. Give me your heart, and I will take control. I will help you through this crisis and every crisis that comes in your life. So he's saying, we're not just regular people. We're royal people. And he's saying to us that it is time for us to have that vision. It is time for us to put Jesus Christ first and foremost. And the only way we can do that is we have to seek him daily. When we wake up, when we're in the car, when we're going to the dry cleaners, at work, you've got a situation, stop gossiping about it. Stop tearing people down. Go to Jesus Christ and let him handle it. Let him show you what to do, what to say, and maybe not say anything. So he's saying, seek me first. Seek God first. That's what he's saying. First. And then, if you're going to have 20/20 vision, and you see I'm squinting, I do not have 20/20 vision. I need help. I wear glasses. So he says, you need help to have 20/20 vision. And that focus, the Word of God. That's how we keep our focus. Prayer, coming to prayer meeting, coming to Sabbath school, being intentional. And he said, and then I will fulfill my purpose in your life. So America and Americans need Jesus Christ. And they need to hear it from people who are real and authentic and can say, I don't have it all together, but I know a God that does. I don't know all the answers, but I know a God that does. I've made mistakes just like you, but I know a God who can deliver and who can save and will save. And that is the beauty and the flavor of America. In a crisis, we have a God who can and will handle everything if we allow him to. So I say to you, seek him, focus, and allow his will, his purpose, to be fulfilled in your life. In Jesus' name. Bow your heads with me. Father, we say thank you. Thank you that you love us so much. Thank you that there is nothing too hard for you, and you can do everything.
Amen.
Help us to know we don't have to be afraid, but to walk in faith, to focus, and you will fulfill your purpose in our lives and in this world. So Lord, we say thank you today. Help us to go from this place knowing that you love us. Help us to stay with you and be focused and put you first, not just today, but every day. I ask that you pour your spirit upon each and every person here. Bless, guide, and keep them, Lord. Keep us. Keep us, our minds stayed upon thee. Father, help us to endure to the end with you. Bless, guide, keep. Bless this church family, bless the pastor, bless the leadership, bless all to stay the course, to be faithful to the end with our trust in you. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, let us all say together,
amen.
God bless you.